ties into what the previous speaker and the previous have talked about, which is that the plant medicines create connectedness between humans. They create a sense of community. Burning Man creates a sense of community, doesn't it? Like, we're making eye contact. Imagine there's New Yorkers here. We're making eye contact. Right? You're a New Yorker? Well, I'm going to present to you something that is new, as of this month, from science. And that it is a kind of psychedelic that we are birthing in science that will potentially be able to roll the whole system. And we will roll science, roll metaphysics, roll philosophy, roll AI, and evolutionary biology, and our sense of where we are living in the cosmos, our purpose in the cosmos, and our roots. So I'm going to bring the thing out. Let's do my little stack here. This is the first time that our ancestor has been to the bird. So what this is your ancestor. Joe Rocking Burn this week. This is a stromatolite from Western Australia that is the oldest evidence for life on Earth. The little ridges that almost look like a beautiful female heart are rock textures laid down by fabrics of microbes. This was picked up by me in Tumbiana in northwestern Australia a year ago, right about now. And this is all part of this. So this is the cover of Scientific American for August. And if you'll notice the writing at the top, we knocked the eclipse off the cover. So this is significant. About 4 years ago, I remember sitting in Zendo, and it was only me and Carolyn Ferris and Rick in Zendo, and I was pretty elevated. And Rick gestured over to me. So like a supplicant, I went to Rick, and of course, Rick just simply listened to me talk about science for an hour until my charge, who was responsible for me, grabbed me and pulled me away. But what I was talking to Rick about was that we're on the path of finding a new way to think about how life began on Earth. And this is now out to the public. It's been published in technical journals, we've been in chemistry, and we're finding out something really cool. So let me show you the results. So here it is. This is the model theory for how life began on the Earth and potentially Mars and anywhere else. And see that cycling, spiraling thing? You see it on the page there? But it's indicating wet, dry, and moist pools. What dry and moist, cycling round and round and round, is the engine that can lift life into existence out of fittest. But you'll see in the top right corner, there's a little squiggly thing called the protonote. That's as the bubble bath bubbles get more and more dense at the bottom of the pools, they snuggle together and they start sharing things. And what they're sharing is the polymers that were synthesized in the previous dry down, that means to survive the wet down. And they start squiggling together, and they create the opinion of the protonote, which is the build-up phase of the living world. And science, we're now at step three. We're making the primitive version of this thing in the lab. I went to Yellowstone National Park, which is depicted on the cover of the Grand Prismatic Pool, in June, and I was able to make these vesicles in actual hot springs. And in a volcanic vent, I grew our RNA. Holding a slide tray in the vent gases last year at Bumpus Hell, we grew RNA 40 base pair long. So what does this all mean for us in our struggling world of politics and our survival as a species? It means a lot. Because it means we can tell a new story. The new story is, you guess what the new story is? What's the old story that science and perhaps
where politics and economics has told us about how we emerge and how we succeed in the world. Huh?
Survival of the fittest.
Survival of the fittest. Yes. Dr. Charles Darwin hated that term, by the way. He was convinced to change his book on the origin of species to use survival of the fittest by a critic who didn't like natural selection, because he said, well, it assumes there's a selector, so they're promulgating this idea of a god, of a hand. And Darwin just grudgingly changed it to survival of the fittest, which is a Victorian term, right? Very Victorian. Of course, we're the fittest, we're the white people, the top hats. We're in jackets in the desert, so we must be crazy, right?
Indeed.
So, Victorian term, and it has caused mayhem. It has caused mayhem. I had a conversation with what I call the guy in boldest one night, and she grabbed my shirt collar and she said, you listen to it. I just showed you how you remain. I showed you the process. Your man Darwin got it right. But you're using the wrong language. It's destroying the world, and it's destroying you. Because it creates separation, survival of the fittest. You've got to be crazy. You know how evolution works. Now, we're going to have a new start, a new cleanup sequence. But we started from this little mass of prey cells that couldn't even divide on their own, for God's sakes. They couldn't do anything. All they could do was share the innovations that they had with the other protocells. This is the unit that would be selected for in the Hadean pool 4.3 billion years ago. Not individuals, a community, a group. Huh? Does that make sense? We had to be smushed together in order to survive those conditions. And we're not individuals. The origin of life is not individual, it was a community. Huh?
Sweet,
huh?
So science for the win.
Science for the what?
Science for the win.
For the win? So that rock texture that you saw just a moment ago, its ancestor was a community. Huh? So the whole planet under your feet is an ocean. Did you know that? It's a wet ocean. It's like 1,200 feet deep. It's wet sand crowned with microbes that are tolerant to alkaline conditions. Right, and they're just rocking away. They're in the gel phase. They're in this phase. But they share innovations all the time. The entire planet is a protein planet. It's a single microbial mat. The whole planet. Trees are just microbial mats that learn to create living so they can stick up. Right? And then we are evolved grazers. Right? We're grazers. We just munch along through this mat. We have the illusion that we're separate. Like, I'm munching along. Sheep don't think they're separate, right? They're chewing away on the ground. They're kind of looking at each other, but they chew as a unit, right? But we are like, guard my hamburger, you know? We're the only species that has a separate thing, you know? It's incredible. Birds aren't separate from each other. You know, birds aren't separate from insects. When you go to the rainforest or any forest, what do you hear? A symphony of song. Why are they singing all night? There's no evolutionary adaptation advantage to sing all night with frogs and toucans and everything. You know what I mean? They're just doing it because it connects them to one another. It's consciousness. So the good news, the gospel is, and here's how it will roll all these people. So do you know about Copernicus? Do you know what Copernicus did?
Revolutionarism, yeah.
Yes, so Copernicus, and he was very wise about this, published after his death, so he didn't lose his head on his grant funding. But he basically argued that with the planet sort of circle around the Earth, they circle around the sun, right? Sort of a little bit of a challenge to the powers that be. And he worked the center. Well, this has been described by some of our colleagues as a Copernican revolution, because instead of these situated at our origins, the idea of allegiance itself, as I'm fighting with you, therefore I get better tools because I defeat you, right? It's not how it happened. It was a sharing system. Huh? Incredible. It's a Copernican recentering. Here's how it pulls all these fields. I got a 10-page email from Ken Wilber. Do you know Ken Wilber?
Yeah.
10-page email from Ken Wilber saying, oh my God, this completes my life's work. This shows that spirals all the way down. right from the start point. This shows how the whole line emerges. This shows where we can go from here. This shows us where spiral 6 and 7 are, you know, if you're into this spiral thing. To get an email from Freeman Dyson. Blah, 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 blah. Genotype, phenotype, and his brain, 95-year-old brain is like, no, this is it. I have nothing more to say. Terrence Deacon, Elizabeth Sartoris. I'm going to roll this back to Richard Dawkins. Everyone will find wisdom for their world in this new idea. So we can roll philosophy, we can roll politics, we can roll metaphysics, we can roll evolutionary biology with this thing. This idea will ripple through. And don't know much more that I can say. Anyone got a? I could offer one more thing. I'm not sure how much time.
You got time. Okay, there's about 5 minutes left, and then we're going to go and roll into the next presenter, and then we'll have a large format Q&A.
So that's about it. So this is today here at Burners Without Borders, I'm launching a movement. And the movement's the following. Albert Einstein in 1905 published 3 papers, anyone who has those papers? In the German Iron. Then in 1916, in the height of the war, he came out with general relativity. So he nailed special relativity, general relativity. His hair was not gray yet, it's not frizzy. And then it was tested in 1919 at an eclipse. Like when we just had the hero up in Oregon, going, whoa. And the guy was looking at us. So it was tested on an eclipse. So think of the patterns. Think of the parallels here. So I was like, so it was tested, and then he became a scientific rock star as a result of that, because he showed that the starlight bent around the sun, and that light bends and spaces curve, and it's fantastic, right? Well, we think that, what they did was then he became a superstar, got the Nobel Prize, and in 1921 he came to America, and he toured America in an open top car with Charlie Chaplin, and with flags waving and everything. So first scientific rock star. He turned to Chaplin at one point in some town and said, what does this all mean? What does it all mean? And Chaplin said, absolutely nothing. So that was 1921. So today I'm announcing and launching, hopefully, a grand tour of scientific rock stars in 2021 to celebrate a bunch of new things, doing it the way that Sir Einstein did it. Anybody has like frizzy hair is invited. But I'm going to be in the open top car with Bill Murray, who gave me a hot dog on the way in, and wrote, "No one will believe you on the wrapper." Or you can try those movies in the open top car. Talk at 3, by the way. Duncan and I are going to talk at 3 at Pointing Market.
What's it about?
Okay, so what it is a tour, it's a road show to recenter humanity on this powerful new Copernican idea. To recenter, and it compels all of you. Because it's the gospel, it's the good news. Because we can roll everything. Because it comes from hardcore chemists. It comes from the most hard-nosed reductions you can imagine. We're going to be actively trying to grow proteins to win Nobel Prizes, huh? And they're going to get scared when they see that first bubble mass come up. And it's adapting, and they stress it with ultraviolet, and they come back up, then they go, whoo! You know, even the hardest nosed Nobelist is going to get that. So it's going to come from the bottom of science, ultimate credibility, and we're going to see in dishes this thing growing and shrinking and getting stressed and polymers and things that fall in for it, and say, this is how we began. This is our ancestor. Oh my God, if a world of religion enrolls everything, you're like, wow, what do you do? It's like seeing the Earth from space. What do you do about that? It's total fact, like, Earth from space. My God, it rolled the 60s, you know, whole Earth catalog and all that. So, 2021.
How fast can we accelerate the evolutionary process to observe it?
By donating money.
We're going to move on to the questions and answers before we get this incredible group up there. So if you've got one
question. One more thing. The origin, not of life, but Burners Without Borders. Just a brief thing. So in 2005, I was in a camp called Playa Gon, Pentagon and Playa, back behind Media Mecca. And our colleague Dave Werner, was extreme calm. So he was Ed Bondiace, he was doing the relief for the hurricane, the tsunami. Then went to Iraq, and then went to Afghanistan, and he came to the fly, and he was so stressed. And tell this man was stressed, because he had just operated off of aircraft carriers, dropping phones to people, literally people. Incredible guy. So we heard about Katrina. So we have Iridium phones to the Pentagon. We get on the phone to Admiral Lindwell, and Dave wants, like, Blackhawks to come here and take him out, to go and do the relief. He finds out the federal government is blocking all the efforts that he wanted to do. He's so pissed off. He's so pissed off that one night, I'm sitting in a colo in our shipping container, and I look over on the IMAC, and it's like a great big National Reconnaissance logo on there. I said, Dave, what are you doing? He said, shut up, and he turns the screen. He hacks into an NRO satellite, I'm not sure which one it was, and we took it over, and we started to track Katrina, because it wasn't being freaking used. National security, I said. So, and I, you know, anyway. So we were watching the eye roll going over New Orleans. We watched the levee breaches. We watched people walking on this, you know, there was like dots of people running away. And Dave said, there are going to be people trapped in rooftops. The buildings are going to be on fire. I've got to get down there. I've got to get down there. Then Joan Baez came to the camp. And she sat down in front of the families and said, oh my God, she loved New Orleans, right? That was her heart city, Joan Baez. She said, we got to do something about this. This devastation that nobody knew here. There was no cell phone service. And so she created a concert at the temple called, Prayer for New Orleans Concert in the Temple in 2005. And we all went up there, and there were 10,000 people there. And she sang from David Best's bus. It was incredible. And they didn't know what she was singing about. And she was saying there was a disaster happening in this beloved place called New Orleans, and we handed out these water jugs and empty water jugs, and it was like $10,000. And the concert was over, and what do? Well, we created the Katrina Information Center, handed out brochures and stuff, and we created a table. And then the most heartfelt thing for me is there was a woman that was a circus performer. She lived in the night, or, you know, that place kind of poor part of New Orleans. Dave brought her and showed her what was going on in her neighborhood and the flooding. And she said, oh my God, I can't go home and it will never be rebuilt. My life, world life is gone. The fighting circus procession will never happen again. And so there were all these refugees around our camp. And we said, we're not going to give this money to the United Way. We're going to give it to people right here on the burners who can't get past the Houston Astrodome to get home. So we just gave it out. And I grabbed a sign off the center camp to take it home that was painted to announce the temple concert that hangs in my house. And that's how I got connected with Burns. And I heard that Burns had gone down to the Gulf to reconstruct the parish church that year. And that was the birth of Burns Without
Borders.
And
a Vietnamese Buddhist temple in Biloxi, too.
And a Vietnamese Buddhist temple in Biloxi. So, I'm so honored to be back here and to share that story, which I think is the origin of this movement of coming and doing these good works in special disaster areas. But start right here, and right here we're taking over freaking whatever satellite it was to figure out what was going on. Taking that federal government resource, and we're taking it over to do good work. You know. So I want to thank you for your time.